Hi everybody, this is Dr. A, and we're going to talk more about analytic techniques in this video. We are covering electrochemistry. We're going to start with potentiometry. So the principle is it's the measurement of electrical potential and a voltage difference between two electrodes in an electrolyte solution. The reference electrode has a constant voltage, and the sample electrode is a measuring electrode that is in contact with the sample. The ion concentration is calculated from the measured potential difference between the two electrodes. It uses the Nernst equation to get the concentration from the voltage reading. So the Nernst equation is an equation that relates the reduction potential of a reaction to the standard electrode potential, temperature, and activities that are often approximated by concentration of the chemical species undergoing reduction and oxidation. One of the applications is the ion-selective electrodes. These are used all across clinical chemistry in the large analyzers. They are membrane-based, and that's what makes them selective. The membrane responds to a certain ion in an electrolyte solution. So those ions can be sodium, chloride, potassium, etc. The glass membrane, the makeup of the glass can vary, obviously, responds to hydrogen ion, and that will make it a pH electrode. The silica in glass is the makeup of the sodium membrane in the sodium electrode. Valinomycin is the makeup of the membrane that measures potassium, and the membrane that measures chloride is a solvent polymeric membrane. And so each of these ion selective electrodes are separate, right? And they will each measure free ion concentration in the sample. So if you want to measure sodium, potassium, and chloride in a sample, you would have three electrodes, three ISCs. One, the first one would be specific, for example, for sodium. It would measure sodium, and then the sample will go to the next one, and the next one would measure potassium, and it would go to the next one, and it would measure chloride, and you get all your results, and it, send them over to the computer. So this little graph shows you, you've got the external reference electrode, internal reference electrode, the reference solution, and the membrane, and the analyte solution, which is going to be the sample for us. Okay. So that's a very basic diagram of the ISC. So in chemistry, you will see direct ion selective electrodes methods. They use undiluted samples. They are very sensitive to free ions. But they do not detect bound ions. The advantage of the direct ISC methods is that they are not affected by high proteins or high lipids. This is a method that is often used to measure ionized calcium. The indirect ion selective electrode methods use diluted samples, and that is what is used in most big chemistry analyzers. The one problem, though, is that high protein content and lipemia can interfere with the readings, and they tend to underestimate the electrolyte concentration because of higher protein and lipid contents. It is called the volume exclusion effect. So let's look at the pH electrode as an example of an ion-selective electrode. So it is a glass electrode that measures hydrogen ion activity. The indicator electrode is a silver wire that's coated with silver chloride, and it is immersed into the internal solution of 0.1 millimoles per liter of hydrogen chloride, and it is placed into a tube that contains a glass membrane, which is only sensitive to hydrogen ions. So only hydrogen ions can cross that membrane. So when it is in contact with the sample, the movement of hydrogen ions near the membrane produces a potential difference in voltage between the internal solution and the sample. And this is measured as pH and read by a voltmeter. So the reference electrode in the pH electrode, the combo electrode there, is made of either silver and coated, a silver wire coated in silver chloride, or calomel, which is mercury coated in coarse mercury solution. And it is immersed in a potassium chloride solution. The voltage is generated at the surface of the mercury and its salt. A cable will connect the mercury wire to the voltmeter, and a tiny opening at the bottom of the reference electrode will complete the electric circuit between the indicator and the reference electrodes. And so the measurements can take place. Another application of this is a modified pH electrode is the PCO2 electrode. So it's a gas sensing electrode. So it has a thin gas permeable membrane that allows CO2 in. You have CO2 here, and it's coming from the sample, and it's crossing over the glass permeable membrane. And then there's a chemical reaction that happens because it's going to interact with a sodium bicarb solution. And so as the CO2 interacts with the sodium bicarb solution, the pH of the sodium bicarb solution is going to change and produce hydrogen ions. And then the hydrogen ions are going to cross over a second membrane, the glass membrane that's permeable to hydrogen ions only, and then it's going to be red. So it's basically a pH electrode with an extra membrane that is permeable to CO2. So the equation that is happening here in this part of the electrode is that CO2, for every molecule of CO2 that crosses over, it will pick up a molecule of water. It will become carbonic acid, which will then disassociate into hydrogen and bicarb. And so the more hydrogen ions that are produced, the more of them will cross over. So for every CO2 that crosses over, there's a hydrogen ion molecule that is produced. And so from that, you can equate the pH change to the CO2 concentration. All right, and then you also have the Clark PO2 electrode and the gas sensing electrode. So it works on the amperometry principle, which is a measurement of the current flow that is produced by an oxidation reduction reaction in an electrochemical cell with the application of a constant external voltage. So it measures the partial pressure of O2 in blood using an O2 sensing electrode. And so the components of it are going to be a gas permeable membrane that is allowing oxygen only to cross over, a cathode, an anode, and an electrolyte solution. And so the metal plus the electrolyte solution of the wire that's in contact with the electrolyte solution allows oxidation or a reduction reaction. So it produces a flow of electrons due to the reduction of oxygen. So what's happening is for every molecule of oxygen that is crossing over the membrane, it will interact with the water in the electrolyte solution. And as it interacts with water, it will be reduced and it picks up 4 electrons from the electrodes that's producing the current, right? And then for that, it makes 4 hydroxide ions. So every oxygen that crosses the membrane is going to pull 4 electrons of current. So the more oxygen crosses over, the more electrons are being pulled, the higher the current. And so the magnitude of the current is going to be proportional to the amount of oxygen in the sample. And then there's a couple more miscellaneous ones in electrochemistry. So conductometry measures the electrolytic conductivity. So if a solution can conduct electricity, basically the current is going to be proportional to the amount of ions in that solution. So electrical conductance can be used to assess water purity, and you're basically trying to run electric current across a certain width of water, and the higher the reading, the more ions are present, the less pure the water is, meaning pure meaning free of ions if you've run it through a deionization process, for example. Because basically, the more ions there is, the faster and easiest the current can run through, jump from ion to ion, basically run across there. So another application of conductometry is the Coulter principle with electrical impedance. That's where it counts the cells, and every time a cell comes through and breaks an electric field, it counts one. And you can count red cells and white cells that way. And then another application is coulometry, which is based on amperometry. So again, the Clark PO2 electrode was amperometry. And in that, the quantity of electricity in coulombs is that is needed to convert the analyte quantitatively to a different oxidation state is what coulometry is. The product of the current in amperes and the time in seconds required to reach the end point yields a number of coulombs, and this has been used in the measurement of chloride in sweat, in which coulombs is proportional to the quantity of chloride in the sample. The sweat chloride is very much of an outdated test. It's been widely replaced by genetic testing that's done at birth as part of the newborn screening process, but sometimes that thing comes up occasionally, so I thought I would just add it in here at the end. So, all right, so that wraps up electrochemistry, and we're going to do some more on electrophoresis next. I'll see you there.